Hello students, welcome to a lesson through the virtual training center of the Brihan Mumbai Mahanagarpalika. My name is Shraddha teacher, and in this lockdown period, since we are not able to go to school children, we will be doing many lessons here online through the virtual class. So come on, let's proceed to our lesson for today. Let us start a new lesson, children, today, and the lesson will be for standard 10th English, and we are going to look at a lesson named Let's March. And this lesson, children, is lesson number 2.5 in your English textbooks. Now, when you look at the word March, there are so many things or so many ideas which comes to your mind. March is a month of the year, isn't it? But when we say let's march, it is about doing something physical, that is like doing march past or going for a parade or something like that. So does this lesson have to do anything with a physical activity or physical exercise or sports? Not at all. This lesson deals with social issues. Now, as we read the lesson and as I explain the lesson to you in the further videos, you will realize that this lesson has got a lot to do with not only social issues but also certain skills in English. All right, now you will wonder how in one lesson we can do so many different things. So let me assure you, this lesson is going to be fun-filled and it is going to be very informative and also, of course, very, very interesting. So come on, let's march and let's see what this lesson number 2.5, Let's March, has to offer to us. So you must have recalled, children, that I told you that this lesson deals with social issues. So let's first look at what social issue this lesson deals with. So we all know, children, that in society today, there are various kind of conflicts, there are various kind of challenges and various kind of crises. We call them as our social problems. Okay, now these social problems are not confined only to our country, not confined only to India. It is not that people only in our country are facing these problems. People the world over are facing with these problems. Okay, but the nature of the problem may differ from one country to another. Now, in the United States of America, they have different kind of problems. Okay, in a country like Pakistan or Afghanistan, they have different kind of problems. Whereas we as Indians, we have certain unique social problems in our country. So remember, all over the world, whether you're staying in a developed country or whether you're staying in an underdeveloped country or whether you're staying in a country where there is a lot of terrorism issues, there are conflicts, there are crises, there are challenges anywhere that you live in the world. Now let us try and focus on the challenges that we face in our country, that is India. So in our country, we have many social issues, children, but majorly the issues that we are faced with is the problem of gender inequality. Okay, it is not that this problem is not there anywhere else in the world. It is there in many countries in the world. But now we will talk about the problems that we as Indians are facing on the social level. So these are the social issues in our country. Okay, so the problem of gender equality. Now, what is the meaning of gender equality? Gender equality means men and women, they are treated not in an equal manner. Okay, they have different, men and women have different roles to play in the society. But both their roles are equally important if the society has to survive. But somewhere or the other, we have this kind of a mentality that men are more important than women. So women do not have as much a social status as men have. So this is one issue that we are faced with in our country. Along with this, we have another great problem in our nation, and that is the problem of illiteracy. But children, this problem we have addressed on a war footing. Okay, we have many programs which the government has ensured, like we have the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, and then we have the Right to Education Act. And because of so many things, we are improving slowly as far as illiteracy is concerned. So the figures are getting better and better. Okay, if you compare India of the 1980s to India of the 2020, you will see that a lot of improvement has happened as far as illiteracy is concerned. So illiteracy is like a life sentence. So what is a life sentence, children? It is like some punishment which you carry with you your entire life if you do not know to read and write. See, this boy, he wants to extend his hand and he wants to read so many things. He has got career opportunities in front of him. Okay, he will get a lot of financial advice. He will get a lot of advice on how to be healthy. But unfortunately, he does not know how to read. And that is why this particular problem is pulling him back. So he wants to do a lot of things in life, but unfortunately he is illiterate. So illiteracy will go with him to his grave. So as long as he is alive, if he makes an effort, of course he will be able to read and write. But otherwise, it is like a punishment for life. Okay, so this is also one very important, you can say, social issue, a very serious social issue in our country. Then we also have issues like dowry cruelty and dowry death. So in our country, I told you, it is always portrayed that men are very, very important and women are not so important, which is absolutely wrong. But the portrayal is like that. So when a girl has to get married, the parents have to give away huge sums of money and gold and property and things in the form of dowry. But in spite of all this, the girl is still ill-treated. So she is given cruel treatment in the name of dowry. And sometimes she is also killed in the name of dowry. So that is dowry cruelty and dowry death. But children, again I told you, like our country has improved a lot. When education becomes important, when people become educated, then these kind of social problems will automatically start going into the background. Okay? So because of increased reach of education, this problem of dowry also has slowly and slowly started diminishing. It has not gone away, remember. It is still existent, but it has become less. Now, we discussed about a few of the problems in detail. Along with this, there are so many other problems, children. For example, look here, the problem of human rights and equality. Okay, the problem of healthcare. In India, we know we have a lot of issue with healthcare. Now, during the pandemic, it was revealed that there are no beds in the hospital, there are no ICUs, and there are no ventilators for patients. So there is a lot of issue as far as healthcare is concerned. Then there are problems with the government. We have political problems. Okay, we have problems regarding education. Why problems regarding education? Again, the same thing, inequality. Children, people do not want to send their girl children to school. They send only their boys to school because they feel that the girl will eventually get married and she will go away. So what is the point in educating her? Which is very, very wrong. Okay? Then you have problems like unemployment, low wages, and so many other issues. Now, one issue which is hidden in all this is a very important issue that we are going to talk about in today's lesson. So I told you, today's lesson will be about social issues also. So which is the social issue that we are going to focus on today? It is the issue of child abuse and child welfare. So in this particular lesson, we are going to talk about child abuse and child welfare. We are going to talk about child labor also. Okay, so come on, let's see what the meaning of child welfare is. So in this picture, you can see so many children, and one of them is also specially abled. Okay, see, he's on a wheelchair. So child welfare basically means what? Child welfare means services which are designed to ensure that children are safe. So to ensure safety of the children. Now this safety does not mean only physical safety, but it also means mental, psychological, health-wise safety also. So what is child welfare? Child welfare means making programs or designing services in order to see that children are safe and so that families can have the necessary support to care for their children also. For example, now parents who are poor, who cannot send their children to school, the government is providing free education for those kind of children, isn't it? So the family has been given the necessary support to care for their child's education, isn't it? And in the school also, the child is being given so many things free of cost. He's been given the midday meal. You have the doctor coming and checking up the child and giving medicines if required. So the welfare of the child, the well-being of the child, the development of the child, if you are taking care of it and if you're making programs in order to take care of it, that is called as child welfare. Okay. Now, let us see why this child welfare is needed. So you can see two pictures here. One is a child weeping and the other is a woman weeping. So remember, these kind of programs, whether it is for child welfare or whether it is for women welfare, why it is needed? Because women and children are considered to be the soft targets. Soft targets means they can be easily harassed. You can make them victims very easily. Okay, they are victims of capitalism, development, environment. So whenever you want to make any development in society, whenever there you want to set up factories or any kind of environmental issues are there, these women and children are the worst affected. They suffer in a number of ways because, what are the reasons that they suffer? Because they are considered to be weaker. Now, this idea is also changing. You must have seen that in the past, women were not recruited in the army, etc. But now you will see women are working in the army. They are even running trains. They are driving auto rickshaws. Okay. And they are flying planes. So this idea that the women are weaker is definitely not existent today. They are also considered to be helpless. Okay, helpless. Why? The reasons may be many. Like I just told you that women and girls are not sent to school. Okay, so they naturally are not educated. They are illiterate. They don't know to read and write. So they are helpless. And because of the same reason, they become economically dependent also. They don't have their own money. They're not earning. They do not have jobs. So they have to depend on their husbands or they have to depend on their fathers, their brothers, their sons for their living. And the main issue is the issue of illiteracy, because of which all the other problems come up. Okay, so that is why it is necessary to have programs for women's welfare as well as for welfare of the children. Okay, so now when we talk about child welfare, there is one particular issue that the main, you can say, person in this lesson, the lesson whom we are, who's focused on a particular person here. Okay, we will come to that person gradually. So this particular person is focused entirely on this aspect of child welfare. So what do you think this picture shows? So you can say six small children smaller than you, okay, in age. You are in the 10th standard, so you might be 15 years old, 16 years old. But look at these children, poor children, they are so young. Some of them are hardly 7 and 8 years old. Some of them are even younger than that. What are they doing, children? So some of them are working and the labor is so, you can say, so difficult. It is not easy physical work. All right. Like, for example, children go and deliver newspapers. They do it along with the studies. They do it just like that for fun. That is a different thing. Okay. But look here. The children are made to dig the ground. They're supposed to carry water. They're supposed to carry heavy loads. And they're working on construction sites. And by looking at them only, you can understand that they are not at all happy doing it. Okay. They are being forced to do this. So what is this issue called? This issue, which comes under child labor, child welfare, is called as the issue of child labor. Okay, child labor means what? Employing children who are supposed to go to school in the workplaces. So suppose a child, now see, look at this brother and sister pair. One picture is shown as wrong because here they are made to do some work. Whereas in the other picture, you have a green color circle in which there is a tick mark. That means this is the right thing to do. So please, you should see to it that whenever you see around you also, you should try to report these things. That children should not be made to work at construction sites. You will see children working in the chai ka thelas or in the restaurants or the dhabas on the highways. Okay, even that is not permitted. So child labor should not be permitted. You should not employ a child in your house to work. And if you see a child being made to work forcefully or even otherwise at some place, you should immediately try and take some action with the help of your parents. Alright, so this is the focus of our lesson for today, and this is what the protagonist in our lesson, that is the person who is the main character in our lesson, is working towards. He is trying to abolish child labor. Okay, there is one more aspect to this lesson, that is we are trying to talk about the oratory skills. We will look at how you can improve your oratory skills. So what are oratory skills? Oratory skills means how can you write and deliver a good speech. Okay, so delivering a good speech. Now if you're a politician, then of course someone else will write the speech for you and you have to only go and read it or say it. But as students, we should know how to write a good speech also and how to deliver a good speech also. Deliver means actually go and say it. Okay, so some parts of this lesson also focuses on how to develop your oratory skills or how to write a good speech. Because this entire lesson, children, is a speech which was given by the main character in our story. Okay, or in our lesson. I will not call this lesson as a story, but it is based on real events. So you can call it as a real story. Alright, so we will talk and discuss a little bit about how to develop your oratory skills also, which is the warming up part of your lesson. So come on, when I said warming up, let us go to the warming up part of your lesson. So any lesson in English, as we have discussed earlier, is divided into three parts. We have the warming up activity, then you have the main lesson, and then you have the English workshop part, where you do a number of exercises in grammar, etc. So let us today start with the warming up activity. And what is the warming up activity first? First warming up activity will be about child welfare. Okay, so you're supposed to observe both the pictures and answer the questions which are given below it. Look at the two pictures. One picture you have see a small child, hardly around 8 or 9 years old, working in a brick kiln. Okay, so this is a place where bricks are made out of clay or soil. The soil is kneaded and then it is shaped into the form of bricks. After that, it is baked in this bhattis or in the furnaces, and they are arranged and then they are sold. So here, these are tiny children, tiny kids, they are used as cheap labor. See children, when you employ a man to work, a grown-up man, you have to pay him a lot of money per day. Okay, even women, they are paid little lesser than the men, I think, but even then you have to pay them a good amount of money. But what if you employ a child? You can make the child work for half of the cost. Of course, the child will not be able to work that much, but even then, you will get some or the other kind of work done from the child. That is why people encourage child labor, which we will try and see how we can reduce. So what is the main difference between the two images? What do you think? Observe carefully. In the other picture, the boy has got a backpack, in which you can even see a water bottle. He is on a cycle, wearing a uniform and going to school. So think, what is the main difference between these two images, children? In one, the child is enjoying his childhood and going to school as well. See, he's got a nice bicycle and he is happily, merrily riding on his way to school. So he's enjoying his childhood, he's going to school. What about the other poor child in the other picture? he has to sadly earn for a living. Maybe his parents are not able to provide for him and his brothers and sisters. Maybe they are very poor and they need him to earn. So he has to sadly earn for a living at this tender age. What is the change required? What do you think? What is the change which is required in this picture? So should we try and send this boy on the bicycle to work with the bricks? No, we do not want that to happen. Then what do we want to happen? We want that both the children should get equal opportunities in life. So both of them should be able to enjoy their life. They should be able to play. They should be able to go to school, learn a lot of things and grow up and be mature adult citizens who are educated, who are earning well, who are supporting themselves and their families as well. So this is what we want for both the children, isn't it? Now the next question is, again, you have to think as individuals. What will be your contribution as a student? And how will you try to make a difference to the needy children? So there are many children around you also, the places where you live. There are so many children around you who are needy. Needy means they do not have everything in life. Okay? Now everything doesn't mean that they should have a car and they should have a plane and they should have all the video games possible. No. When I say everything in life means whatever is necessary for a child. Education and a good life, good food and safety. Okay? So what can you as students do in order to make a difference in the life of such needy children? Think about it. Come up with an answer. And discuss with your friends also. Now you're not able to meet your friends physically, but you always keep in touch using WhatsApp or you call each other. So come on, start a discussion about how you can help these kind of needy children. Okay? So this was part one of our warming up part. Let's go to part two. Like I told you, we are not only going to discuss about social issues, we are also going to talk about how to deliver or how to prepare a good speech. So you are supposed to put a right tick or a wrong tick. Okay? And you're supposed to try and see which points which are given below are correct as far as a good speech is concerned and which ones are not so correct. So you have 8 points here. Let us see which ones are right and which ones are wrong. So the first one is well planned and thoughts are well organized. So you have planned your speech well and your thoughts are organized. That means they are coming in sequence. So is this a good thing for a speech or a bad thing for a speech, children? I think it is a good thing for a speech. Okay, look at the next one. Should your speech be delivered softly and in a low voice? What will happen if you talk very softly and in a low voice? Will people be able to hear you? No. So there is no point. People won't understand what you're saying, so they will not appreciate what you're saying. Okay? Let us take one more point here and then I will ask you to decide. So the speaker need not greet the dignitaries and the audience. Now this is like when someone calls you on the phone or when you call someone, you directly start talking and you say, see, I wanted to come to your house and I wanted to you to give me the shirt. You directly come to the point. Is that right or wrong? I think it is wrong. Because when you're calling someone, you should always say hi, hello. You should say, how are you? I hope you're fine. And then you should get to your point. So the speaker should not greet the audience and dignitaries. This is wrong, isn't it? So now look at the other points. I'll give you a minute. Look at the other points. You can pause the video and try to see whether the other points are right or wrong. So after a minute, you can come back and then check with my answers and see whether our answers are matching. Okay? So the language used should be suitable to the audience. Correct. Right. It is a good characteristic. Speech should be of proper duration. Very true. If you go on speaking and speaking and speaking for half an hour, people will get very, very bored. Okay, they will want to get up and go away, but they will not do it because they want to be polite. speaker should be passive and should not have any facial expressions. That is, you should not have any kind of expression on your face. You should speak like a statue. Is that true? No, it is not. You should have a lot of facial expressions. You should use your voice modulation, etc. Speech should be supported by good examples, episodes, visual aids, wherever possible. Correct. True. You should always support your speech to make it interesting. What about speaker should switch over from one language to another? This is wrong. If you're speaking in one particular language, you should try your best in order to continue to speak in that particular language only. If for some time I will speak in Hindi, then I will speak in Marathi, then I will speak in English, again I will go back to Hindi. Some people who are sitting in the audience might get confused. So, if possible, try not to switch over from one language to another. So these are the qualities or the characteristics of a good speech. Okay. Now there are some more exercises here based on how to put a speech together. So see, there are some expressions here, and there are certain columns here, okay, in this table, and there are certain expressions also. The expressions we will see later because I could not fit the entire thing on one page. So these are the columns. So you have a column for greeting and salutation, you have a column for introduction, you have a column for body of the speech, you have a column for conclusion and thanking the audience. So this is how a speech should be. It should have all these parts. Okay, now they have given us certain expressions. There are 12 expressions. So the first one is, imagine after 10 years, what will happen? Second expression, let me begin today by sharing my own experience. Look at the third one, honorable chief guest, eminent dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen. So there are so many other expressions. You are supposed to read all of them carefully, and you're supposed to try and see in which of the columns it will fit. So let us see, in greeting and salutation, I think this expression will fit. Good morning to one and all present today. So this is one of the expressions that can fit into greeting and salutation. Search for some more expressions which can go in this column, okay? Because there are almost 12 statements, 12 expressions, and only 5 columns. So in one column you can fit in more than one expression. In introduction, what will I write? I can write, let me begin today by sharing my own experience. This can be part of my introduction. What about the body of the speech? I can write, let me give you an example. When I'm talking about the topic, in between that, I can say, let me give you an example of this topic. All right. In conclusion, what will you say? You will say, before I conclude, I would like you to think over the fact that. What about, how will you thank the audience? You will thank the audience by saying, thank you all for a patient listening and your interest in my talk. So see, you have 5 parts to the speech. You have part 1, which is the greeting and salutation, part 2, which is the introduction, part 3, which is the body of the speech, then you have the conclusion, and then you're supposed to thank your audience. So this is pretty much like how you write a letter. When you write a letter also, you write various points, isn't it? You write address of the sender, the date, address of the receiver. So in the same way, if you have to write a good speech, you have to keep in mind that you cover all these points, that you should greet the audience also, you should introduce the topic of your speech also, and your speech should be structured properly in the body, and you should conclude, and also you should thank your audience. So if you keep make an effort to make all these points properly, or to write your speech according to these particular points, I'm sure you will have a very, very good experience with speaking on the stage. Okay, children, so this was about the skill that I told you, preparing and delivering a speech. Let us now talk about the little bit more about the lesson. So the person who is the main, you can say, character in the lesson, his name is Kailash Satyarthi. We are going to talk about him very shortly. He was a Nobel laureate. Now, who's a Nobel laureate? A Nobel laureate is a person who has received a Nobel Prize. So a Nobel Prize is a prize which is given in various fields, okay? So you can get Nobel Prize for literature, you can get one for science, you can get one for medicine, for mathematics. So it is a internationally recognized award. And getting a Nobel Prize is supposed to be a very big honor, not only for the person who's receiving it, but also for the country. So there are many Indian Nobel laureates. So we have asked you to look at the internet or to look at the school library and try and find out the name of the Nobel laureates. Okay, so now I will give you some time so you can go back to your internet. You cannot go to your school library right now. And you can check out these names or I will give you certain names. You can read them and find out some more names. Okay, so let's see who are the Nobel laureates in India. So you have Rabindranath Tagore. He won the Nobel Prize for Literature in the year 1913. Literature means writing, stories, novels, poems, etc. Then we have C.V. Raman. C.V. Raman won the Nobel Prize for Physics in the year 1930. Later, we had Hargobind Khurana, who won the Nobel Prize for Medicine in the year 1968. So you see, you have people winning the Nobel Prize for Literature, for Physics, that is related to science, for Medicine. Okay, and then you have V.S. Naipaul, who won the Nobel Prize again for Literature in the year 2001. Apart from these children, these people, there are so many others also. Okay, you have Amartya Sen, who won the Nobel Prize for Economics. So come on, try and find out what more number of people can you find from India who have won the Nobel Prize. Okay, now let us come to the main person in our lesson, that is Kailash Satyarthi. He is the main character in our lesson. He said that child labor is equal to child slavery, and he's an anti-child slavery activist. He has said something very important about child labor. He said that child slavery is a crime against humanity. Humanity itself is at stake here, means humanity is in danger if you encourage child labor. And he also has taken a promise or an oath that he will see the end of child labor in his lifetime. So as long as he is alive, he will see to it that he will fight to end child labor. And see, he is also the Nobel Peace Prize winner for the year 2014. Let us look at some information about Kailash Satyarthi ji, which is given in your textbook. So he is an Indian children's right and education advocate. So he's done law also, and he is an activist against child labor. He has founded the organization Bachpan Bachao Andolan in the year 1980, and he has acted upon various issues in order to protect the rights of more than 83,000 children across 144 countries. So not only in India, but all over the world he has fought for child labor. He is honored with many awards, including the Nobel Peace Prize of 2014. He has addressed this speech on the eve of the Nobel Prize distribution ceremony. That is why we looked at speeches also, isn't it? Because this whole lesson is in the form of a speech. So this was the you can say introduction part. Now we have almost taken up more than 30 minutes. So the remaining part, children, we will do it in the next. So children, wasn't that a wonderful video? And did you enjoy watching it? So if you want to watch more such videos in future, then please like this video and also subscribe to our channel, the MCGM Portal for Education, and also hit the bell button so that you get notified whenever I upload a new video here. Thank you so much for now. Let's meet again soon.